Welcome.
Welcome to the Longview Heights SDA Church Service.
We are so glad you are worshiping with us today.
Please call your friends to join you as we worship God. We are ready to praise God.
We are ready to praise God.
Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you again for another Sabbath and another service. Forgive us of our sins and wrongdoings, known and unknown. Lord, help us to have a character like you and to allow your spirit to move through us. Thank you for our elders and thank you for our youth, for we all need you. Help us to be ready for your near return, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
She likes boiled eggs, and she likes to eat salad sometimes, and she likes sandwiches. I like to watch Night at the Museum. I like to play baseball with her, and soccer, and frisbee. When she lets me help her with stuff. Thank you, Mom, for being the best mom, and I hope you have a good Mom's Day. Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Works at FedEx, and she is picky about how the house looks and what we're doing to help out around the house and stuff like that. We play board games and watch TV and go bike riding around the neighborhood. She's just not hanging in there. Mom, I love you, and whatever happens in the future, then that will never change. Happy Mother's Day.
Well, she works for herself. She makes a lot of money. And she is very, she does stuff for other people that she really doesn't have to do, but she does. I like to go out and eat with my mother. I like to go out to like art, like go to arcade and stuff like that. I like to go out with my mom. She loves me also, she, like I said earlier, she like makes a lot of money from working for herself. So yeah, and I get, so she worked for herself. I get to spend a lot of time with her. I love you, Mom, and I miss you. Happy Mother's Day.
She's very extra, but I love her. I mean, she's very people oriented, so like she'll go out her way for people, and I like that. It's admirable.
She's short. She has her own nonprofit. Very independent. Very honest as well.
We just goof off. She's very hilarious, actually. We cook together, watch movies together. I help her with her nonprofit stuff. We just do a lot of stuff together.
I like to do a lot of things. I just like to be around her mostly because I don't really talk much. But I like to watch movies with her and get on her nerves a lot. So.
the fact that she raised three girls by herself, that's a lot. Especially when they're all teenagers at the same time. She can deal with that. That's a lot. So that makes her special to me.
I mean, she's a good mother. She's a single mom. My nonprofit's about, so. How honest she is without trying like to be a pushover or, you know, trying to make people seem like they're a bad person, but she's gonna tell you the truth about how she feels about something in the nicest way she can. And how she's not overprotective, but how protective she is of, you know, everyone.
I mean, you know what's up? I love you a lot. And I don't know what I'd do without you. So I appreciate you and everything you do. Yeah, that's it.
Well, I love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
It is the time of the service where everyone can participate. You can give your tithes and offerings in any of the ways on the screen.
It's like you're looking through a telescope. You see where you're going to be. Growing, getting better. You're not the person they see. Can't be mad at the things you've been through, because they built your muscle. Now you're stronger than you've ever been. They can't stop. Your prayers and you got-
Dear Jesus, thank you for all the tithes, and please bless everyone who couldn't give tithes today. And much love to everyone. Amen.
When you spoke to me.
listening.
Good morning. I'm so thankful that you're joining us here at the Longview Heights Seventh-day Adventist virtual worship service. We know that God is in this place, And it's so awesome that you're here too, that God has led you and God is keeping you. We know that God wants to share his truth with you. And the Longview Heights Church family, we want to welcome you. We want to make sure that you feel at home as you worship with us in spirit and in truth. God is leading us even in these difficult days that we're living in. When there is so many different things going on in this world, it's indicating that God is winding things up. And Jesus is sure to come. Soon, we believe that Jesus will come through the clouds of heaven. But we want to be ready for that glorious day. That's why it's important for us to study God's word and to have connections with God and to share his truth with others. God is calling us to be his disciples. So today, the Lord has a word to share with you. But before we speak God's word, let's talk to him. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, which art in heaven, speak through your word again this morning. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Scripture text is found in the book of Acts, chapter 10, verse 28. Acts chapter 10, verse 28. The Bible says, "Then he said to them, 'You know how unlawful it is for a Jewish man to keep company or to go to one of another nation. But God has shown me that I should not call any man common or unclean.'" This morning, the message is entitled, "Call, Conflict, Conversion." Call, conflict, and conversion. The gospel changes everything. It changes everything. There was a businessman named Zacchaeus that was actually a con artist, but he met the gospel. The gospel changed Zacchaeus, and he began to be a faithful tithe and offering giver. He was able to repay back the things that he stole from others because the gospel changed him. There was a Samaritan woman that was abused by men, and many things happened to this woman, so much so that people did not want to associate with her. But she met the gospel at the well, and she forgot that she was there to get water, because the gospel changes everything. There was a demon-possessed man that lived among the hills and the rugged rocks, and he would have chains on him, but they couldn't hold him down. This man no doubt had problems with domestic violence, but he met the gospel. And when people saw him after he met the gospel, he was in his right mind, because the gospel changes everything. There was a Samaritan that had leprosy. And when Jesus healed him, this Samaritan came back and said, "Thank you, Lord. Thank you for all you've done for me, because the gospel has changed my life. Even a fish sandwich can be changed by the gospel to feed 5,000 people. The water that meets up with the gospel is turned to wine, and storms that are ready to blow ships out of the water, when they meet the gospel, these storms are silent, because the gospel changes everything. There's something unique about the gospel. There's something that is unifying about the gospel. The gospel is universal. It touches everyone's life, regardless of what race they are, what language they speak. It doesn't matter what you look like and where you've come from. The gospel has the power to change. The gospel is unexplainable in its power because it goes beyond all of the things that would normally stop something. The gospel is able to touch the hearts because the gospel changes everything. In our scripture text today, we have a story that is so full of truth, a story that we need in the present times that we're living in the polarization of our country, in the fights that goes on between Jews and Arabs, in the conflict that goes on in the minds of men as they decide to follow God or not to follow God. This story is a story that we need today. It's a story about Cornelius. Cornelius was a man that loved God, but Cornelius was not a Jew. He was not an Israelite, but he loved God, and God called Cornelius. The good thing about God is that you don't have to be a church member for God to call you. You don't have to be going to church, or you don't have to have a righteous behavior. God will call people that don't even know his name. That's the thing, because the gospel is so powerful, it goes beyond our walls of separation. So Cornelius, he had a relationship with God. He didn't know everything about God. He didn't know about Jesus. He didn't know about the salvation that was made on Calvary. He didn't understand all the things about salvation, because he only knew what the Jews had taught him. He only knew the Old Testament, but he loved God, and he would give to help people. He would show that he was interested in helping people's lives and changing their lives for God. God had called him, and because God had called him, he exemplified a behavior that showed he had a relationship with God. He was always giving. One day at 3:00 in his own home, the Bible says that an angel met him. An angel began to talk to him, and he called him by his name. The angel said, Cornelius. An angel of brightness was there, and he called him by name, letting Cornelius know that God had called him. He knew about him. He knew about his prayers. He knew about his gifts. He knew about his behavior. And he said, I want to teach you something. I want you to learn about salvation. But this angel did not have license to tell Cornelius the truth. In order for Cornelius to learn the truth, he had to find it from another human being. Angels, their job is not to spread the gospel. That job is given to humans. We are the witnesses that God is going to use. He wants to use somebody that's human. He wants to use people that have gone through struggles. He wants to use sinners that have been saved by righteousness. And angels have never sinned, and so they really can't tell the story like you and I can tell the story. We know what it's like to call on God. And so Cornelius, he could not hear the truth from the angel. The angel gave him direct and clear instructions to find Peter. Go find Simon, whose surname was Peter. He told him what town he was living in. He told him what he was going to be by the sea. He told Cornelius what the house looked like and who owned the house. See, God knows everything. He gave him clear instructions. And so although this angel could not tell Cornelius about the gospel, he could tell him how to get to the gospel. Cornelius had to search for truth. He had to go out of his way. He sent his servants and a soldier that he trusted, and he said, go find this Peter. and bring him back because Cornelius was called. Like, I like the idea that God will call you even when you're not calling God. God will reach out for you even when you have no idea where he's telling you to go. But an angel told him, go find Peter. He'd never heard of Peter before. He didn't know who Peter was. He did not have a Facebook account. He could not go on email. He didn't know his phone number. But the angel of God told Cornelius, I'm calling you to reach out. And when you do what God says, you're always able to find what God wants you to find. So Cornelius went to search for Peter. And while he was searching for Peter, God was working with Peter. See, Peter loved God. Peter had spent time with Jesus. He had seen him turn men that were blind to where they could see. He had seen him not only work miracles, but he listened to the parables. He saw how he was punished on the cross. He knew all of these things, and his life, you think, was changed. But Peter still had some problems. See, Peter loved God, but he had some conflicts. He had some conflicts. He was conflicted. Traditions were controlling Peter. Traditions of his church. Things that his church said. These things that his church said were not from God, but from misguided men, saying that Israelites and Gentiles cannot meet together, forbidding Israelites and Gentiles from sharing the gospel, from becoming friends. And these traditions were controlling him. And so for the longest, Peter would only talk to Jews. Peter would only talk to people that were like him. Peter stayed in his area. He stayed in his community. He did not venture out to tell others about the gospel. He only worked with the people that were inside his little area. Peter was a religious racist. Although he had spent time with Jesus, he still did not really want to have anything to do with people that were not Jews. Although he had heard many statements that Jesus had said and seen him talk to the Syrophoenician woman, still in Peter's mind, he was not willing to give the gospel to anybody that unless they were Jews. The Holy Spirit began to work on Peter. He was on the top of the house, the Bible says. He was on the roof, and he went into a trance, into a vision. And he saw a tablecloth that was knitted and that was held up on four sides. And on the cloth was all types of food. And it just so happened that Peter was hungry at this particular time. And there were some catfish there. There was some pork chops there. There was some raccoon there. There was all sorts of food, some meats that he knew he was not supposed to eat. He knew these were unclean foods. And a voice came from heaven and said, Peter, kill these things, these animals, and eat them. Cook them, barbecue them, stew them, whatever you want to do to them. And Peter said, ah, no, Lord, that's unclean meat. That's foods I should not eat. And again, the second time, the vision happened. And then the third time it happened, and Peter was not sure what God was saying. He was confused because he knew what the Bible said, but now it seemed like God was saying to him that it was okay to eat unclean foods. That's what it seemed like. At the same time, the friends from Cornelius were knocking at the door. And the angel of God told Peter, there are some people at the door that want to talk to you. Don't be afraid. Talk to them. And when they ask you to go with them, go where they want you to go. Peter went down, and true enough, Cornelius' friends were there. And as they explained to him that Cornelius had seen an angel and told them to go get Peter, and they asked him if he was Peter, and he said, yes. They said, we want you to go with us to Cornelius. And they stayed in the house of that night, but then the next day they went to see Cornelius. And there Peter was with Cornelius, and Cornelius had brought his whole family. He brought his cousins and uncles and aunts. He brought his closest friends, and they were all in the house because they wanted to hear what Peter had to say. An angel had told him to get Peter, and now he wanted to hear what Peter had to say. And Peter said, now, why did you bring me? And Cornelius was saying, we want to hear the gospel. We believe that God has some information to give to us. And we believe that if you teach us the gospel, that we will follow what you say. Peter was excited. For the first time in his life, although conflicted about talking to people that were not Jews, for the first time in his life, he understood God had shown him that he should call no man common or unclean. See, for the longest, Peter would call the Gentiles unclean. He would call them a common people that he shouldn't have anything to do with. But God was showing him that you are to work for people that were not Israelites, that were not Jews. This story is not about what you can and what you cannot eat. It's not giving the okay, the permission to eat unclean foods. No. This story is letting us know that God expects us to witness to every human on the planet, every person, that we should not hold the gospel just for ourselves. The gospel converted Peter. Peter was leaning towards God and giving his life towards God, but there was some things wrong in his life. He needed some changes in his life. He had heard Jesus say, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses for me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and into the uttermost part of the earth, in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. But he didn't quite understand it until now. And for the first time, Peter understood that God expected him not just to preach to people that were like him, but to preach to people that didn't have anything to do with God. People that were from a different nation, from a different culture, from a different color, from a different way of life. It was a change for Peter. It changed him. Here, see, Peter was converted on the housetop. Peter was converted when God expected and explained to him that you are to go to people that are not Jews. And for the first time, he was able to teach and he was able to preach. And so he began to talk to Cornelius, and he began to share the gospel with Cornelius. For the first time, Peter was able, because of the power of the Holy Ghost, to preach the truth to somebody that was not a part of his clan, not a part of his group, not a part of his team, somebody on the outside, somebody that he would not normally talk to. God is trying to tell us something. He's trying to let us know that we must reach out to people that may not have our same color, may not have our same dialect, may not have our same language, may not see things the same way we see them. Their culture may be different. There may be a different ethnicity, but God expects us to reach people all over the world and teach them and live the gospel in front of them. Not only was Peter converted, but Cornelius was converted. Cornelius had learned through Peter, he was learning the life of Jesus, that Jesus lived upon this earth as a man, and he gave us an example of how to live a godly life. He learned that Jesus died on the cross for the sins of the world. He learned that 3 days later, he rose up from the grave. He learned that Jesus is in heaven making intercession for us. And if anyone calls on his name, that they can be saved. Jesus was taught to Cornelius, and Cornelius accepted Jesus, and the Holy Spirit fell upon him. And Cornelius and his whole family were baptized. And they became disciples for the Lord Jesus Christ. All because of this conversion. This was a change for Cornelius. This just changed his whole world, because that's what the gospel does to you. It changes you. It converts you. The gospel converts us. The gospel, if you let it, there will be some conflicting situations in your life. There's going to be some jobs that will cause you to wonder if you really can live the gospel. There's going to be some things that happen maybe in your school or in your neighborhood. There will be situations that will be conflicting that will say, no, you can't share the gospel. No, you can't live the gospel. But if you trust God, he will give you converting power, and he will change the way you live. Oh, yes, there's some confliction in our homes, in our families, and in our friends. But the greatest conflict that we have is actually in ourselves. Our own ego, our own pride, our own desire to do things our way. My selfishness will cause me not to share the gospel and keep it to myself, but it is a conflict. It is a conflict because I easily want to just go to church and not have anything to do with anyone else. But when you really love God, the love of Christ will constrain you. It will change you. It does something in your life. It will make a difference. The gospel has a power to convert you, even in your conflictions, even when you don't feel like it, even when you feel like you're not good enough, even when you feel like God is not listening to you, the gospel has a way of changing you. Oh, yeah, sins are forgiven because of conversion, because of what Jesus has done in our lives. We are converted. Conversion changes who you are. Grace is favored. Healing is felt. Peace is found. Faith is firm. Slaves are free. And the guilty has a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Why? Because the gospel will change you. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. Don't that sound like a change to you? Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. God does something in our lives, and he's the only one that can do it. He converts us. He changes us. He makes us something that we can't change ourselves, that we can't do ourselves. He does it because he loves us. The Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 10, and verse 9, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. I wish I could get a witness in here today that there's something about the gospel that changes you, that makes you a different person. You can't be the same anymore. You won't talk the same anymore. You can't go the same places, because God will change you. The converting power of the gospel. Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. There is a change that God wants to work in my life. There is a converting power. He not only has called us, he not only knows that we have conflict, but he wants to have a conversion in our lives. He wants to turn us. He wants to make us just like him. This is what he does. He does it through his word. He does it through his providential workings. He uses the Holy Spirit. But I want you to understand that all of us are called. God wants us to be saved. God doesn't want anyone to be lost. We are called to service. We are called to sacrifice. We are called to be saved. Just like God called Cornelius, he's calling you. He's calling you, but he knows that we have conflicts. He knows that there's going to be some obstacles in our way. He knows there's going to be some people that will try to stop us from this change. He knows there will be some issues in our hearts and in our minds and the way that we grew up and our traditions that say, no, we don't have to do it that way. See, these conflicts are usually traditions, are cultural things, and the Word of God is going beyond our conflicts. The Word of God is against the things that we used to do. I know we normally like to lie, but God says, I want you to be truthful. We normally want to be adulterers and adulteress, but God says, no, I want to change your life. We normally want to disobey our parents, but God wants to change us. We normally want to put another God in front of the God of heaven, but God is trying to change us. We normally want to bow down to idols or to take God's name in vain, or we normally want to lie or steal or kill, but God wants to change us. God wants to change even our worship. That's why he says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. There is a change that happens. It is conflicting because most of the world wants to do whatever it wants to do. It wants to follow its design. God is saying, if you follow me, there's going to be a change in your life. You can't be, you know, we don't like change. Most of us, we want to keep things the same way they are. But if you follow God, he's going to change you. He's going to change what you wear. He's going to change what you eat. He's going to change where you go. He's going to change everything, because if you're in Christ, you are a new creation. If you confess Christ, he takes things out of you and makes you a different person. That's what I like about God. Whatever he makes us is much better than what we really are right now. Oh yes, it's going to be a conflict. There's going to be a conflict. But he will convert you if you let him. And when you let him, you will be so happy. You'll have so much joy in your life. His converting power does something that you and I cannot do. Listen, maybe you have a friend that needs this converting power. You can't change them. Maybe you have a husband or a wife or a child that needs the converting power of God in their life. All you can do is pray and ask God to do the converting. All you can do is live a life, an example of Christ in front of that person. Maybe in your own life, there's some addictions that you feel that you can't get the victory over. But God can give you some converting power. He can change who you are. He can change your name. He can change your thoughts. He can change your attitude. If you let him, he can change everything about you. That's the God I serve. He's not only able, but he's willing to change you. If you just let him change you, it's not that difficult just to say, Lord, change me. Lord, change me. I know I'm messed up, but Lord, change me. Like Cornelius, we can come before God and he can change every part of our lives. Like Peter, he can take the prejudice, the racial biases away from us. He can take our sins and not only forgive us, but he can give us power to live victorious Christian lives. Maybe you want to be changed right now. The good news is the gospel will change everything. If you let him, if you believe in him, he will change your life right now. Do you want that change? Will you pray with me today? Father, which art in heaven, I want you to change me. I need your changing power because I am a sinner. I need you to heal, forgive, strengthen. Somebody else here today, Lord, that's listening to this feeble voice, wants to change. Somebody else today wants to accept you as their Savior. Not only have you called them, but even in their conflict, you want to give them conversion. Thank you, God. Thank you for doing it right now. Thank you, and we pray and praise your holy name for your convicting, converting power in our lives. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. May God bless you this morning. Have a wonderful Sabbath day.
want to invite you and all of your friends to be a part of our Friendship Bible class. In our health study, you will learn how to feel better, look younger, live longer, lose weight, feel great, and improve the quality of your life while making new friends. In our amazing Bible facts study, you will learn how to add years to your life. What happens when you die? Can you die before your time? Can your loved ones come back from the grave and talk to you? In our church history and Bible prophecy study, you will understand the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, about the coming of the seven last plagues, when water will be turned to blood, when painful and grievous sores will come on all those who receive the mark of the beast. Who gets the mark of the beast, the number 666? If you call and enroll in our friendship class within the next 60 seconds, you will receive a special gift for being one of the first to call. Call us now, 901-235-2033. That number once again, 901-235-2033. 235-2033. It's free.
Before we end our service, I'd like to share with you our mission and vision statements. Our mission statement is reflecting Christ by connecting, helping, reaching, inspiring, serving, and teaching. Our vision statement is, at Longview Heights SDA Church, we seek to connect all souls with the Holy Spirit, help the weak, reach the lost, inspire humanity, serve our community, and teach God's Word.
Wasn't that an awesome message? Let us pray.
Dear Jesus, thank you for a beautiful Sabbath day you have given. We thank you for blessing our speaker with a powerful message you bestowed upon him. I pray for our sick and shut-in members during this hard time, and I'm also praying for us youth to build a better relationship with you during these virtual programs. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you for worshiping with us today. You may contact us at the number listed below, or you can connect with us on Facebook at Longview Heights SDA Church, or soon to be in the future at 685 East Mallory 38106. Hope to see you next time. Thank you.